Jessica Kingsley Publishers presents Justice for Laughing Boy, Connor Sparrowhawk, A Death by Indifference by Sara Ryan. Read for you by Ruth Galliers. Foreword. I always say that the people who taught me about human rights and the law were my clients. People who were wrongly accused of crimes they did not commit. Women and children who were not listened to when they had been raped, abused, or battered. People who suffered persecution in their homeland, but faced a wall of disbelief when they sought asylum here. People who, because of their race, sexuality, religion, or other difference, were subjected to the pain and humiliation of mistreatment. Vulnerable people who suffered neglect and cruelty or indifference at the hands of the state. Theirs were stories of deep inhumanity, yet securing justice was no mean feat. Institutions close ranks to protect reputations, and persons in authority all too often defend the indefensible. Connor Sparrowhawk was without doubt an extraordinary human being. His learning difficulties and epilepsy may have meant he needed special care, but he was a life-loving, talented, and amazing boy with a hugely supportive family and a great network of friends. He died by drowning in a shabby, under-resourced NHS unit for those with special needs. He was on his own in a locked bathroom when he had an epileptic seizure. No one was within hearing distance. Nurses and other carers had not been informed of his medical condition and received no training whatsoever in how to deal with such an event. This is the human cost of austerity policies. I wept when I read this powerful book. The suffering of families who face tragedy can be unbearable. To their grief is often added the inability or unwillingness of the authorities to explain what happened. When relatives seek explanations, they frequently face obstruction, lies, delaying tactics, and non-disclosure of relevant evidence. Then they are the ones accused of being vexatious and troublemaking. Yet in the face of such wrongfulness, what always amazes me is that some incredible people find resilience and strength to persist in their quest for justice. These are the true champions of human rights. Not lawyers. Connor's mother, Sara Ryan, is a remarkable woman. She could not let the death of her son go unquestioned. She could not rest until she had answers and placed responsibility at the doors of those who were really guilty of failing Connor. Those people further up the chain of command who are richly rewarded, yet rarely held to account. Sara took the arduous course of seeking a public inquest into her son's death. She was supported by the wonderful team at Inquest, a great NGO which seeks open justice for unexplained or preventable deaths. Family, friends, and acquaintances built a strong and vibrant campaign around the tragic loss of Connor. And I am proud to say that a group of amazing, committed lawyers from my own chambers argued the case and fought successfully for the family. Justice involves openness and accountability. Sarah's recounting of her family's journey lays bare the deep inequities within our legal system and our society as a whole. People with learning difficulties and autism receive insufficient support and care. People seeking justice face a system skewered in favour of those with money and resource. This book is both heartwarming and heartbreaking. It is a story of love. The pursuit of justice for Connor was a battle for us all. We cannot remain silent as our welfare state, our health and care system, is starved of resource and brought to its knees. We cannot walk on by as the gulf grows between rich and poor. This book is about the society we live in and duty we all have to care for each other. Baroness Helena Kennedy, QC. Author's note. My name is Sara Ryan, and my partner is Richard Huggins. We have 5 children: Rosie, Will, Connor, Owen, and Tom. Richard and I live in an Oxford suburb with Tom, our youngest. This book tells the story of our family, our son Connor, and our fight for justice. It describes real events, but given the number of people who offered their help over the past few years, some names have had to be left out to simplify the telling of our story. Thank you to all those who have offered help and assistance over the years, and to those who continue to seek #justiceforLB. I died this morning, in the bath. I'm dead now. Mum? Am I dead, Mum? 4th of July, 2013. That morning, 4th of July, 2013. I've patchy memories. Some things remain crystal clear. It was baking hot and I caught the bus into Oxford as usual. I work at Oxford University as a researcher. Fran, a friend who has a son in Connor's class, texted to ask if he was going to go to the school prom the following evening. I replied saying I'd ask him later when I visited him. He was due to visit the Oxford Bus Company that morning. I didn't, and still don't, remember walking through the market in Gloucester Green on the way to work, but later found photos I'd taken. Photos of the remarkably mundane, a sort of final capturing of everyday life in Oxford city centre on a midsummer Thursday morning, of life as it was. I remember I'd bought breakfast or lunch, and unusually for me, put it in the staff fridge in our enormous open-plan office. I'm not a keep-things-chilled sort of person. Closing the fridge door was the last thing I did before my mobile rang. Dr. Jayawant from the unit. Was it a good time to talk? Connor was on his way to the John Radcliffe Hospital. Found in the bath. Unconscious. Sunshine was spilling into the open-plan space through grubby windows. Very few people around still. I headed out of the office, checking details with her. Did I use the lift? I must have. I hung up, walked through the glass doors, back out onto the street, and was heading to the bus stop before the details began to seep in. Was it a good time to talk? Much later, at Connor's inquest, the 999 call that the same consultant psychiatrist made to the emergency services was played to the jury. She was so relaxed and unforthcoming, the responder suggested a 4-hour response slot. Back out in brilliant sunshine, I realised I should probably get a cab. I rang Caroline, our office administrator, to say I was going to the hospital. She came straight down and caught up with me outside the railway station. Caroline has a learning disabled daughter in her 40s. Rich, who is also an academic specialising in political science at Oxford Brookes University, was at a staff event in the town hall. I texted him and Fran from the cab. Calm texts. Connor was on his way to the John Radcliffe. He'd been there before in an ambulance after all. I thought about the information I'd been told in an odd, slightly fragmented way. Found unconscious in the bath. Airway cleared before going in the ambulance. His key nurse was with him and would ring if there was any change. Any change? The black cab crawled along the Banbury Road towards the hospital. The sun continued to bake. Each metre covered brought increasingly harrowing, tumbling and terrifying thoughts. My colleague Caroline remained calm. I repeatedly returned to whether Connor was conscious or not, and whether he might have experienced some sort of neurological damage. This sent me into a sort of hysteria. In my mind, I don't think I shared it. What if he was in a coma? I kept trying and failing to imagine what a brain injury might mean for Connor. He'd been found unconscious in the bath. What did that mean? What could that possibly mean? Caroline repeatedly said we just didn't know. It was a journey that defied sense-making. We pulled up outside the entrance to A&E, realising neither of us had any cash. Caroline had left work without her bag. I had some euros from a recent work trip to Finland. I stuffed them into the driver's hand and ran past reception to the ambulance arrival area. A few years earlier, I'd beaten the ambulance to the hospital after Connor had a seizure at school. On that occasion, he was wheeled out of the vehicle on a trolley, beaming and basking in the attention from the paramedics, ready to go home after a few hours of checks. This time, my friend Mary was waiting for me. She also has two learning disabled children and worked on reception in A&E. She had seen Connor's name appear on the system half an hour or so earlier. Thinking back, I can't imagine what that morning was like for Mary or for Caroline, who travelled with me, or for the serious and sensitive consultant who appeared from nowhere to tell me the bare facts without hesitation. A ventilator was keeping Connor breathing in a resuscitation room to the left of us. There was nothing that could be done. A moment, a lifetime of indescribable terror that unfolded in a hideous slow motion. Part 1. Connor. Chapter 1. What a wonderful world. When Connor was about 4 or 5, I bought a video camera in time for the extravaganza his school put on each summer. Rosie was allowed to duck out of her primary school to come along, and we pitched up to watch the performance called Round the World. Amid the typical cacophony, each school year was led into the hall dressed in traditional clothes from different countries. Connor's class appeared in colourful South American tunics and sombreros and were organised into a jumbled semicircle with teachers and teaching assistants. I eventually managed to find Connor through my viewfinder, his angelic and chubby little face a study in bafflement, seriousness and stoicism, and his head half-cocked. I pressed record seconds before they started singing What a Wonderful World, and managed to capture around 10 seconds of Connor and his classmates singing and signing. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The rest of the footage is a chaotic and inept sweeping of floor, feet and chair legs. At the time, I pegged this as a complete failing on the filming front, those blooming tears interfering with my camera smarts. Now I think the film captured the moment perfectly. Brilliance, poignancy, chaos and uncertainty. And staff offering unending support, enthusiasm and encouragement. At the time I wrote, "In this setting, unlike most others, our kids have no limits." Connor. Connor is who Connor is, really. A friend who had known him since he was a baby said that someone recently asked him what Connor was like. He said he couldn't say much other than he's just Connor, and that pretty much sums him up. We've been asked to describe him repeatedly over the past few years and come up with these blandish statements about quirky, funny, loving, brilliant sense of humour. But these words don't capture the essence of a young man who sat outside definitions of what is considered normal, while often exposing them for their oddity. He skirted mainstream life, dipping into the bits he liked or the bits he was forced to endure because we, school or others, made him. He loved his family, our dog, Chunky Stan, sitting in the sunshine, reading horrible histories, watching YouTube films of lorries loading on and off cross-channel ferries, the Mighty Boosh, septic tanks, Eddie Stobart lorries and London buses. I used to call him my unlikely ethnographer, as his rule-breaking often revealed as much about the banality or stupidity of unwritten social rules as it did about him not doing what he was told. He didn't get involved in the typical bickering and negotiations of childhood. The 5 kids used to have 50p each to buy sweets every Saturday morning, which could involve some serious and sometimes heated negotiations over 3-for-1 pound sweet deals at the co-op. Connor unfailingly chose a packet of fruit pastels every Saturday for about 15 years. He'd ask for one thing for Christmas. This didn't stop us buying him other presents, but that one thing, the Woody from Toy Story outfit, the cattle truck with an opening door, the Rootmaster die-cast model, was what he wanted. The rest was white noise. He had a number of unusual outfits when he was younger. An early learning centre police tabard was worn for a good 10 years, often with an orange pair of plastic binoculars and one of a selection of baseball caps. One summer, on holiday in France with wider family, he took to wearing swimming goggles, out of the pool, with one of those plastic shower caps you get free in a hotel. As he grew older, he became more conventional in what he wore, although his collection of baseball caps continued to grow. He grew into a slender and beautiful young man, with a rock star mop and chiselled cheekbones. His approach to life was one of simplicity, straightforwardness, and delight in the things, the people, and the dog he loved. He was a cool kid, and we all loved the socks off him. Sadly, this coolness was overshadowed during his childhood by diagnosis of autism, global developmental delay, and various other labels. A relentless focus on deficit. We were sucked into the black hole of disability being a tragedy. This was never more apparent than when Connor was about 2 years old and the kindly paediatrician at the John Radcliffe Hospital said there was nothing that could be done and we would probably need to look into some kind of respite as Connor grew older. She could say nothing positive. An obliteration of a lifetime in a few thoughtless words, leaving me in search of somehow curing Connor. I feel a sad angriness about this now. How can you cure quirkiness? And why would you want to? I organised months of autism obedience type lessons, known as LOVAS, at home, which involved Connor upstairs in his bedroom with a series of teachers, in practice a handful of students from Oxford Brookes and a well-meaning woman who was evangelical about training autistic kids, being drilled through various broken-down tasks, tables and tick boxes. He was around 3 at this stage, and his cheeky, cheerful older sister Rosie was thriving at the local primary school across the road from us. I was determined to prize open a space for Connor to get in there somehow, and it wasn't going to happen while he didn't talk and hung out in the kitchen swing bin with the lid on whenever it was empty. Eventually, he started to talk when he was around 4, but the mainstream space failed to materialise. The head teacher at Rosie's school could not be clearer about this during the briefest of brief meetings in her lightly hyacinth-scented office, one morning before school started. One of those non-meetings parents of disabled children become all too familiar with. Your son? Here? I really don't think so. Instead, he was collected every morning by local authority transport and taken to the John Watson Special School in a village about 5 miles from where we lived. He was to stay at that school for the rest of his life. The early years. There were some tough times, particularly before Connor reached secondary school. Epic distress around shops, lighting, sounds, and reversing the car. He could be unreachable, inconsolable, and remarkably banshee-like when something upset him. At that time, I was doing a sociology and anthropology degree, part-time at Oxford Brookes University. Connor was diagnosed soon after I started this, and, like other parents of disabled children, I went on to specialise in learning disability, autism and difference. While I was studying, my mum, a retired building society manager, stayed overnight midweek to help with the kids, as well as providing a magical sprinkling of cleaning and order to our lives. During this time, the things that too often caused Connor distress were the stuff of everyday life. A bus not running, the car breaking down, a wing mirror or windscreen wiper snapping off a die-cast bus model. Talking through what was going to happen that day or the following day while trying to anticipate and feed into the plan any contingencies was a tricky endeavour too often doomed to failure because of the vagaries of life, or due to us failing to fully understand how to break down activities into digestible chunks. One example, of so many, took place on a camping trip. Rich often took some of the kids camping at weekends. The first time Connor went, neither of us thought to explain to him that the trip was for 2 nights. I mean, a camping trip starting on a Friday night, 50 or 60 miles away, has got to be 2 nights, hasn't it? I got a cheery call from Rich in the New Forest on the Friday evening. The tent was up, the sun was out, they'd been to the beach, eaten fish and chips, and everyone was having a ball. I could hear the excited and happy chatter in the background. The next morning, Connor woke and got ready to come home. There was no dissuading him. We hadn't told him it was a two-night trip. Sleep or no sleep was a feature of those early years. Connor, while happy to be in his room at bedtime and throughout the night, didn't sleep much and would often be quite vocal reliving his day. He could mimic voices to perfection, and sometimes it sounded as if his whole class and teacher were in his room. It was fascinating and exhausting, as he had a knack of absorbing phrases or sound bites he'd heard during the day and weaving them seamlessly into his narrative. In contrast, every so often, he'd come home from school and sleep for hours without stirring. This unusual pattern confounded a sleep study he was enrolled on at Oxford University when he was around 6 years old. It was sold to us as a way of helping him learn to sleep better. He had to wear a device around his ankle monitoring his sleep patterns for a week. The researcher came back with a printout chart showing very little sleep and muttered something about a faulty device. Connor repeated the week, which produced similar results. He was promptly de-enrolled from the study. His sleep patterns would skew the overall results. "Hey, what do we do about him not sleeping?" I asked slightly hysterically as the researcher gathered his consent forms, clunky device and study paperwork and beat a hasty retreat down the garden path. Have you thought about a star chart?" The star chart. Christ, I hate star charts. A tyrannical device rewarding good behaviour with stickers with a view to getting a prize after a certain number of star stickers. For kids like Connor, this is about as useful as a fish slice made of Play-Doh. The star chart is really a red flag signalling the limitations of available support and services. These are typically organised in a rigid and inflexible way, venturing nowhere near the terrain you need to traverse in order to provide effective help or support. During these early years, my undergraduate study led to a PhD at the University of Warwick, and I'd read an academic article or book chapter in the bath each night before treating myself to the newspaper or a mag. Connor would invariably be up and chatting away to himself in his bedroom. For months, he would repeatedly call out, "Mum? Are you my mum, mum?" "Yes." "Yes." "Yes," through gritted teeth while reading Irving Goffman's classic book Stigma. A few years later, I started working at Oxford University as a researcher on a project that involved interviewing autistic adults and parents of autistic children about their experiences. One mother told me her daughter had taken a while to work out categories, like mum and pet, and then to understand who belonged in each category. I finally realised what Connor was asking me. "Mum, are you my mum, mum?" "Yes, matey. I'm your mum, and I love you to the moon and back." In 2002, when Connor was 8, we moved to our current home, a 1930s semi in an Oxford suburb. The house had been empty for a few years and needed a complete overhaul. Urine-soaked carpets and mouldy curtains, a kitchen with the narrowest of wooden cupboards, and an understairs larder with stone shelves. That summer, we stripped, painted, and sanded. I remember Connor had one of his frequent ear infections and lay outside in the baking sunshine on the yellowing grass in the small overgrown garden. No moans, groans, or whinging. Between 2002 and 2008, we got the kitchen extended and the garage transformed into a bedroom and bathroom, with half an eye on Connor's early adulthood. Rich and I used the extension for the time being while the kids were upstairs in various permutations of bedroom sharing. Tom, the youngest, and Connor shared a typically messy room filled with Lego, Playmobil, and Connor's growing collection of die-cast models. Connor was given an early learning centre plastic-coated town map when he was about 2, and this was spread out on the bedroom floor where he would lie on the floor, lining up buses and moving them slowly and meticulously. It eventually became Connor Town. The planned location of the haulage company, Connor Co., he dreamed of owning. Our house is just off the London Road in Oxford, the main road from London into the city centre, with a constant stream of buses. The numbers 2, 2A, 280, 800, U1 and 400 to the city centre, the Oxford Tube and X90 to and from London, the National Express to Stansted and airline services to Heathrow and Gatwick. Connor frequently stood looking out of his bedroom window, absorbed in watching the passing vehicles. Summer passed. The school bus pitched up during term time. Special school became an established part of Connor's and our lives. The blog. I began writing a blog called My Daft Life in 2011 when Connor was 15. This was mostly to document the funny stories that happened in our everyday lives. It began as a random combination of observations of life. Mealtimes, days out, holidays, and some travelling adventures and mishaps, illustrated with photos from my ever-ready and always-snapping camera. The first story I wrote was one that makes me chuckle still when I think about it. Connor was around 7 or 8 and was off school with some sort of light-touch illness that meant a pyjama day on the settee, snoozing in front of a video of Barney and Friends on repeated repeat. Late morning, I realised we were out of milk, and after some deliberation, we live about 50 metres from the co-op, I decided to risk leaving Connor home alone and leg it to the supermarket. I spent about 15 minutes carefully explaining what I was going to do and how he wasn't under any circumstances to move from the settee. I rehearsed and re-rehearsed every scenario I could think of to make sure he fully understood that no matter what, he was to stay put, even if the postman knocked or a parcel was delivered. A friend called round. He thought he heard a noise. Chunky Stan wanted to go out in the back garden. He was to stay put. He was to stay put on the settee watching his beloved Barney. I would be gone for minutes. I grabbed my purse and left the house, realising the second I pulled the front door shut, I'd forgotten my key. Fear and hysterical laughter. I started to try and communicate with Connor through the window. You know everything I just told you? Forget it. It's your mum, Connor. He resolutely and steadfastly ignored me. Eventually, with much coaxing, and believe me, it was a lot of coaxing, Connor edged off the sofa and half opened the window enough for me to pull it open and clamber back in. All the while, he never once took his eyes off that singing purple dinosaur. It wasn't long before my blog developed a readership beyond immediate family and friends, much to my surprise. It was written anonymously. Connor was Laughing Boy, or LB for short, with no identifiable location, but it generated interest, and my reasonably regular rehashing of what was often funny mealtime banter or other everyday exchanges seemed to resonate with people. Many of the posts were simply a few lines reporting a snippet of daily life. Connor had a school diary in which his teachers wrote a paragraph about his day, and I'd often ask him to elaborate on these. This, from October 2011, is just one example. Hey, LB, how did meal prep go today?
Not good, Mum.
Oh, why not?
I failed, Mum.
What do you mean you failed?
I failed, Mum.
Why? What did you cook?
Kebabs, Mum.
Oh, I don't get it. What went wrong?
I didn't have a skewer, Mum.
Oh, why not?
Dunno, Mum.
So what did you eat for lunch?
Bits, Mum.
It was an irreverent, spontaneous snapshot of family life where things were less than straightforward, with a good dose of humour and swear words. I love lorries, Connor, and buses and coaches.
Do you love lorries, Mum?
Yes. Mum?
Do you love lorries, Mum?
Yes, I do. I look out for them all the time, wherever I am.
Why, Mum?
Because you did.
Mum, I love lorries, Mum.
I know, Connor.
How do you know, Mum?
Because you told me.
Did I tell you, Mum?
Yep, all the time. Chapter 2. Dog days, holidays and life rafts. Holidays were always a bit of an adventure at best. not least because of the inevitable disruption to predictable daily routines and the level of planning that needed to be carried out beforehand and throughout. It's probably fair to say we had a spiky holiday profile, factoring in the British weather, the octopus-like herding skills necessary for chasing around five lively kids, and random events like a cheerful driver very gently ramming into us at a roundabout in the Lake District, leaving the boot out of action and a long journey home with belongings piled high on our laps. When Connor was about eight, we had two consecutive holidays renting a college in Kirby Lonsdale, straddling the border of Lancashire and Yorkshire. It was a spectacularly located house, hidden away on the bank of the River Lune, which could be reached by a very steep, short road from the town centre. We hung out by the riverside under a tree canopy, with the kids paddling and building dams, had barbecues of an evening, and Chunky Stan pretending not to see the giant rabbits that faced him in the garden each morning. One day, after flicking through the bulging set of leaflets in the information folder in the cottage, we decided to visit White Scar Cave, a nearby tourist attraction. We turned up, bought tickets, the kids were given hard hats, and we waited to be guided through the cave. I later wrote about the tour on my blog. We went to White Scar Show Cave once, Britain's longest show cave 1 mile underground. We put on our helmets, LB loves anything to do with emergency services, and set off in a party of about 20. Our guide, a white-haired cave enthusiast, led us along the narrow passages until we reached the highlight of the tour, Battlefield Cavern. It was spectacular. The guide asked Rich to turn the light off as he was standing by the switch. There was a collective, ah, as we stood on a wooden platform, marvelling the glowing stalagmites and stalactites. But switching off the lights was not a good idea. LB started to quietly pray. Hey? Dear God, please get me out of this cave safely. We all looked at each other. A few people turned round to look at him. Dear God, get me out! God, help me! Shh, LB! Shh, now don't be silly. Shh, LB! Hissed the kids, nudging him. God, Johnny English, dear Johnny English, save me, Johnny English. Shh. Save me from the cave, Johnny English. Help us! The roof is going to fall in! We are all going to die! Oh, crap, 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 crap. Things disintegrated pretty quickly at that point. Britain's longest show cave and all that. A mile underground. Turn the light back on, shouted the guide, as Rich scrabbled around trying to find the switch. Children started crying, parents got agitated. LB kept praying, loudly. It's probably fair to say we got out of the cave in record speed. A cross between a fast walk and a jog. Parties coming the other way were forced against the wall as the guide followed very closely by LB, still calling for Johnny English, went into emergency exit overdrive. Eventually, we saw daylight. LB stopped praying and cheered up. Funny little lad, said the guide, panting. Is he all right? There were complicated layers going on that day, and it was a familiar pattern. Connor was scared, and his distress could be intense and unwieldy, demanding complete attention. His distress and the obvious discomfort or disruption it could cause others could upset the rest of the kids. Rich and I would be upset that one, some, or all of the kids were upset, or that other people had responded inappropriately. As a bit of an aside, instead of tutting, staring, or glaring at what you might think is the behaviour of a naughty or spoiled child, it would ease the lives of families enormously if you could simply ignore the minor disruption to your life or just smile. As the years passed, the responses of unknown others became less stinging and pretty much faded into irrelevance. Regular disruptions in public spaces became so commonplace that they evolved into a source of fascination and occasional amusement. These experiences led to my PhD focus on mothers' experiences of going out in public with their busy children. In 2011, when Connor was 15, we rented two yurts on a North Devon farm. A breathtaking setting, and for once, the weather was sunny and warm. The first couple of days were a bit tense, as Connor became convinced the farmer was on Interpol's most wanted criminal list. He repeatedly raged and gesticulated at him from a distance, in between staring intently at the ground, hands thrust into his pockets, muttering about the need to catch this master criminal. You had to hand it to him. He was nothing if not dogged when he believed a crime or some wrongdoing had been committed. As it was, the farmer somehow allayed Connor's concerns, and they ended up collecting eggs together in a companionable silence. On most days, Rich, Owen and Tom would go off fishing while Connor and I hung out on the farm. Once the Interpol issue was resolved, Connor found contentment in the space like he did at home. He spent a lot of time with three bullocks, which Rich referred to in his talk at Connor's funeral. Gentle and compassionate, his innate understanding of the way things would be was imparted in quiet chunks of insight, determined questioning, and at times reassuring homilies. One holiday in Devon, he spent many hours talking to three fine Aberdeen Angus bullocks who faced their last days before slaughter in a nearby barn on the campsite. Touched by their plight, Connor sought to reassure them that despite the inevitability of their impending doom, they would feel little or no pain, that they were headed for better things, and, as this was their destiny, they should embrace it and not worry or be distressed. When asked where this better place might be, he replied, "The supermarket and dinner plate." His compassion real, but also realistic. The epilepsy. Epilepsy crept into our lives with some stealth, brief absences and disappearings. Small signs were missed, but picked up retrospectively, such as an incident when Connor was about 5, described by the GP as a febrile seizure. There were odd moments of distraction. It was only when Connor was 15 and we were watching the film Up, with the kids squidged together on the settee, that the penny dropped. Connor became so distressed about the danger to the granddad that he fleetingly lost consciousness. A terrible penny. A friend who was researching experiences of epilepsy had recently interviewed a couple of parents whose children had died of SUDEP, sudden unexplained death in epilepsy. This is a contested diagnosis because it tends to happen when the person is alone. A sadness and low-level fear entered our lives at that point. Getting a diagnosis of epilepsy was a familiar battle, as we were batted back from paediatric neurology with the "just a bit of anxiety, perhaps try a star chart" offering. A few days later, I had a call at work from Connor's deputy head teacher. "He's absolutely fine, but Connor is with the paramedics. We think he had a tonic-clonic seizure." Tonic-clonic seizures, or convulsions, which used to be known as grand mal, involve a stiffening of the body and then convulsions and a loss of consciousness. "He's regained consciousness, but is going to be taken to John Radcliffe just to be checked over." That was the time I ran from work to the hospital and beat the ambulance. Our office was about a 10-minute walk from the hospital. Relief washed over me when Connor appeared unharmed. From top of the until then unknown fear scale to overwhelming love for this funny boy who shouldn't have to deal with the additional challenges of a neurological disorder. The next morning, I rang the GP to ask for a re-referral to neurology. This was bounced back because Connor had by then entered adult services, aged 16. There was a referral to adult neurology and 2 or 3 more tonic-clonic seizures and paramedic outings before he was finally diagnosed with epilepsy. It was a mountain climb to diagnosis that I suspect most mainstream kids are not forced to endure. I felt inordinately sad when I later found out that he was never invited to the first fit clinic, an introductory clinic for newly diagnosed patients. The exclusionary roots run so blinking deep. The difficulties we experienced getting treatment for Connor's health needs reflect the difficulties that many learning disabled people experience. I'm convinced autism and learning disability labels eclipse engagement with actual health issues, and this contributes to the well-documented premature mortality of learning disabled people in the UK. The Confidential Inquiry into the Premature Deaths of People with Learning Disabilities, CPOLD, published in 2013, found that learning disabled women die, on average, 20 years earlier, and learning disabled men 13 years earlier than women and men in the general population. These labels are experienced in different ways at different times.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.